How's it going, everyone? Taki here. This is a monumental day for open source enthusiasts and handheld gamers. We finally have a powerful SoC from Rockchip that is a decent upgrade over their older RK3399 processor. This processor was announced back in 2019, and I've been waiting to get my hands on one for a complete showcase on the channel. Today, we're going to take a look at the first product to reach retail status with this new chip, the ITX-3588J from Firefly. I've been testing this processor for the last week, and I have to say that it's one of the best ARM SBCs that I've ever used. It's powerful enough to handle heavy Android games with ease, and it's a beast when it comes to emulation. I want to thank Firefly for sending this out my way for this video. I had a development board on order for around $1,000, and this got to me in the mail first. Inside the box, they've included three antennas, one HDMI 2.1 cable, a set of serial cables, a standard Type-C cable, and SATA power cables and connectors. This board can be powered by a desktop power supply, but they ship it with a 12-volt, 7-amp power brick, and I'm going to opt for that instead. We typically do not see this kind of I/O on an ARM-based system, but the 3588J has just about anything that I could want, and it's a nice change of pace. Rockchip touts this processor as a desktop-class SoC, so it'll be interesting to see if this chip lives up to the hype and the form factor of this product. Speaking of I/O, we have several standard options on the back plate. From left to right, we have DC input, USB Type-C 3.0 with DisplayPort 1.4, VGA and HDMI in, dual HDMI out, dual gigabit Ethernet with four USB 3.0 ports, a set of audio ports, and an SD card slot. The rest of the board is waiting to be populated, but we have other goodies here like full GPIO pins, SATA connectors, and M.2 slots for modems and SSDs. The main module on this board can be removed, and I have it here. Firefly added a big heatsink with a fan in the center, but this can be removed. I'm going to take it off to get a better look at the processor itself. You can see that there's some thermal paste on this board. I plan on doing some air-cooled tests for my own personal data collection, so this will be removed as well. Here's the money shot of this long-awaited processor. Now that we have the module removed from the board and cleaned, let's go over the specs of this guy. The RK3588J comes with the RK3588 CPU. It's an 8-core processor with 4 Cortex-A76 cores at 2.4 GHz and 4 Cortex-A55 cores at 1.8 GHz. Our GPU is the latest generation from ARM, and it's the Mali G610 MP4 at 1 GHz. This processor also has an MPU capable of 6 TOPS. The RK3588 can support up to 32GB of LPDDR5 RAM, but mine came with 8GB of LPDDR4X. For storage, we have 64GB of eMMC 5.1. For network, we have Wi-Fi 6 on a carrier board with Gigabit Ethernet and Bluetooth 5.0. Many operating systems can run on this chip, but today we're only going to take a look at Android 12 and Ubuntu. As you can see from the chip specs, this is a huge jump from Rockchip's last flagship processor, the RK3399. I have an SBC with that processor here on the right. This is the Orange Pi 4 LTS, and we're going to do some direct performance comparisons between both of these chips just so you can see how big of a jump this is for Rockchip. As I mentioned, I have removed the heatsink from this module for some testing that I need to do, but I will put it back later after applying some MX4 thermal compound. I don't know how hot this thing can get, given that it is an 8-nanometer chip, but I want to give it the best chance of success during these tests. Given that this board fits inside an ITX case, it would probably be a better idea to go with a larger and quieter fan than the one that's on this module based on my experience. Let's start out by briefly looking at the Ubuntu image from Firefly. My end goal for this board is to use it as a Linux PC, but I have heard from other sources that the Linux firmware is not as polished as the Android one at this point. Coming from my RK3568 and my 3399 SBCs, this board is very snappy. Ideally, I would be running this off the eMMC or an M.2 drive, but I have some content that I need to make over on Android first. Without a doubt, this is going to be the go-to chip for Linux handhelds going forward. Here we are in the Android 12 image that's on the internal storage. As you can see, we don't have any Google Play apps. If we head into storage, you can see that we have 17GB for the system, so this must be using AB partitions. The default screen size is a bit too large for my liking, so I'm going to set this to the lowest value in the display settings. I went into the developer options and I was pleasantly surprised to see that they have added a root switch option on this image. Unfortunately, we only have root over ADB and not ADB and apps. Now let's take a closer look at some system info. If we head into the CPU section, you can see our core configuration. One of the interesting things about this processor is that even though the A76 cores have the same maximum clock speed, they are split into two separate groups with their own CPU governor and clock controls. Typically, you would see one governor for all four or three versus one with the newer Snapdragon processors. In display, we can see that our GPU is a four-core configuration with OpenGL ES 3.2 listed. We are going to circle back to Geekbench in just a moment, but I did want to show off the kind of heat that you can get from this processor without a heatsink and air cooling. During this test, the temp climbed over 80 Celsius. The highest temperature that I saw on this board without a heatsink was 85 Celsius, which I assume is where they have set the thermal limit. It's also interesting to note that the Geekbench 5 GPU test crashes before it can finish the OpenCL or Vulkan test. The display configuration seems to be slightly off with this initial Android build, as we're getting some slight jank in our FPS, even though the system states that this is set to 60 FPS. This should be relatively simple for the engineers to fix. My only gripe so far with the RK3588 is that it does not support UFS storage, so we are limited to the older and slower eMMC. I did a benchmark on the storage that came with my board, and I got read speeds of 255 MBS and write speeds of 90.81 MBS. The GPU performance is where things get very interesting on this new chip. For Wildlife Extreme Unlimited, we got a Vulkan score of 1131 and an Unlimited score of 4273. This is roughly half the performance of the same test on the 8 Gen 1 chip. We got just under 6,000 in the OpenGL ES 3.1 test compared to the 805 on the older RK3399. I ran the Vulkan test and was able to max that out without issues. For Geekbench 5 with a fan connected this time, I was able to get a single core score of 543 and a multi-core score of 2299. I have seen higher scores than this from the initial leaks, so this is underperforming by about 5-10%. Even so, this is still 2 times the single-core performance of the RK3399 and almost 4 times the multi-core performance. The current crop of powerful open-source ARM processors sit right around the power of the RK3399, so you can see how big of a jump the RK3588 is. One of the newer additions this time around is the ability to decode and output 8K video. This basically means that the RK3588 is going to be the leader of TV boxes for years to come. I tested out an 8K video and I was able to get playback at 60 FPS without issues. This chip should also be a beast for streaming, but we are limited to what we can do without proper Widevine support or Google App integration with this initial firmware release. I want to take a look at Android gaming performance with this GPU in this video, so we're going to need to install the Aurora Store to grab the apps that we need. This is a decent substitution until we get a proper release with G-Apps. The first game that we're going to look at is PUBG. This game limits the graphical options that we can choose, but I am going to set the frame rate and the graphics to the highest settings allowed. Obviously, we do not have a touchscreen, so this was a bit annoying to test out, but I was blown away by the benchmarks, and I want to see how this will hold up with real games. Whenever I want to capture footage of games like this, I only ever planned to play for a few minutes, but this ended up going on for a lot longer than expected. This was a smooth experience without any performance issues from what I could see. I also want to take a look at Call of Duty Mobile, since it's another popular title with higher options available to us. For these clips, I have the heatsink attached with the fan unplugged. The processor doesn't seem to have any issues like this, so it's a nice option for those that just want to passively cool the processor. This is going to be a big wow moment for those of you that frequently watch my videos. We are going to do my Genshin Impact benchmark. For this, we have the game set to the highest preset with the FPS manually set to 60. For comparison purposes, I'm going to use active cooling on this module. It's set to an overkill level by default, so I don't tend to use it, but I want to showcase how good it is if sound isn't an issue. Over a 30-minute test, the RK3588 had an average of 49.3 FPS with temperatures comfortably under 40 Celsius. This is comparable to the overclocked Snapdragon 845 in the Udon Pro. That is a massive leap for Rockchip, and it will be interesting to see how this processor holds up when it comes to emulation. I'll have more power consumption data for you in my next video, but I did want to list some based on the test that I did for this video. With nothing plugged in and the system powered on, my ITX-3588J pulls about 5 watts from the wall at idle. This decreases to about 4 watts without a monitor connected. Under load, I saw this go as high as 13 watts. But that's going to wrap up things for this video. I plan on doing a showcase of the emulation performance for this chip next, so if there's something that you want me to check, leave a suggestion down below. The spoiler alert, based on my brief test, is that this processor is amazing for emulation. Make sure to get subscribed so you don't miss that video when it drops. Happy gaming, everyone. Taki out.